Welcome to our presentation entitled Evolutionary Movements in Geophysics. I'm Dwayne Dopkin, the Executive Vice President of Geosciences for Paradigm, and I'm joined by my colleagues V. Koran, who's our CTO, and collectively we're going to present I hope an interesting set of topics for you. I have to say, when we started to put a title on this presentation, we thought about calling it Disruptive Changes in Geophysics, but reality is these are evolutions that we've been working on for many years in Paradigm. As you know, geophysics is the foundation of this company. So we thought we'd pick up on some of the items that we've been working on for years and share with you where we believe geophysics will be going in the future. So what I'd like to do is start out with a simple background and setting for the three topics that follow. And I'll spend a little bit of time on discussing our current implementations of machine learning. We have a long history of machine learning at Paradigm. I'll talk about what we're doing today and where we see it going in the future and some of the active developments in that space. I'm then going to turn it back to Svi Koran, and he's going to talk about the unification of data, model, and methods, a very important topic about. In geophysics, we are always upgrading our data. We're always upgrading our model. And today, when we talk about transitioning a project from exploration to development, this becomes a very relevant topic. And then I'd like to conclude a little bit with a discussion about our implementation of our applications, and particularly our geophysical applications on the cloud and a new generation of software. Now, if you take a look back in the last 30 years, and I've been a practitioner, been working with Paradigm for 35 years, and I think about what the big changes were in this industry, clearly from a software development standpoint, we have had step changes in high performance computing and graphics. We've had in this industry a shift from shared memory processors to distributed memory clusters. We've had big movements in graphics, more recently to the GPGPU for computation. We've had a unification of operating systems on Linux and Windows and x86 Intel platforms. So these all have influenced us substantially. Seismic acquisition as well. We're moving from narrow azimuth acquisitions to rich, wide azimuth acquisitions to full azimuth acquisitions. At the same time, we've had also changes with cost-saving acquisitions, simultaneous source acquisitions, continuous recording, compressive sensoring. All of these things have impacted our software development. We've seen big changes in asset focus as well. In the 2000s, we've had a large movement to the big offshore seismic acquisitions, and although they are still extremely active for us in the last 10 years, we as software developers have had to put a lot of time and investment in writing applications to take into account the diversity of data that we have to do to solve different problems in the unconventionals. So that has had a big impact. And of course, data itself, not only the diversity of data, but the size of the data. So these are all the drivers that have influenced our software development in the last 30 to 35 years with different peaks and so forth. As we move forward, we have to start looking at the other trends that are impacting our software. And for the first time, we have now software impacting software. And when I say software impacting software, I'm talking about the ability to deliver software and develop software and support software in a different environment than we had been. That includes cloud, that includes writing applications to take advantage of the rich library of machine learning algorithms that we're going to talk about shortly. It includes making use of the Internet of Things to connect data that we normally don't connect. Whether that's sensor data from the surface with the subsurface, it creates a lot of opportunities as software suppliers. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. So I'm going to now walk us through that first chapter on geophysics and machine learning, and then Svi is going to pick this up afterwards and say a few words about a specific example in here. paradigm's history of with machine learning goes back actually 25 years with the licensing of some technology from ELF that made its way into our StrataMagic application. We've also had some, at the same time, some experiences with other machine learning technologies developed by ENI and others developed internally in Paradigm. The main point here is that we've had 25 years of not only implementing machine learning for automating certain procedures, for classifying certain types of data, but more importantly, we've learned a lot in that 25 years, not only about what classification engines work, but what style of input goes into those classification engines to improve on the results. And as we move through this presentation, I want to move from our traditional implementations, which I'll go through and describe them to you, and talk about some new implementations of machine learning that allow us to combine different types of data. And then also we'll talk about the role of deep learning with respect to petrotechnical applications. One of our first implementations of the neural network was implementation of the backpropagation neural network for first arrival picking. And what we learned about this at the time was, you know, you don't just pick on amplitude, you pick on different attributes of the seismic data. So working with complex trace attributes, envelope, slope, really improve on the first arrival picking. This was one of the first implementations from Paradigm. 1991, we were using the backpropagation neural network where we compute the weights and biases by something called a generalized delta rule. That's still very popular today. And we backpropagate the errors to minimize the difference between the actual outputs and the desired outputs. So this was a very popular application. It's still in use today, and it lends itself to automatic picking of any type of arrival data. It becomes a foundation to do that. Many of you that have used our StrataMagic application, for example, know that the idea of interpreting what goes on between horizons was a very challenging thing in the 1990s. How do I look for changes in waveform shape and propagate those into the interpretation canvases so I can get a detailed look at the data? So this is the Cajon and self-organizing map implementation that was developed or implemented in StrataMagic in 1997. The self-organizing map becomes a very sophisticated way to look for multi-dimensional clusters using a very structured approach that's not biased by outlying events. You, as a user, decide on what the granularity of that neural network is. Granularity means how many neurons or how many faces do I want to classify that data. So it became a very automated procedure to look at what takes place between interpreted horizons, and not only just look at it, to do something intelligent with the results. And the intelligence with the results is to map those classifications in color to take advantage of that structured classification in a way that I can interpret the data automatically. Now, this is an unsupervised classification. It's running on the data the way you sort of give it to it. So we'll talk about some improvements to that. At the same time, we also implemented with ENI another technology to rationalize multiple attribute volumes. This is in our size facies application, where we can take 5, 6, 7, or 8 different seismic attributes and reduce that to a classification that starts with principal component analysis to eliminate some of the noise and redundancy in those attributes, and follow it by also a attribute or multi-cluster dimensional space using hierarchical classification to reduce those 8 or 9 different volumes to a single classification. More recently, we introduced the concept of an ensemble of neural networks. The problem with neural networks is often they get overlearn, they're biased by a single classification scheme based on that data. So we implemented something called the Democratic Neural Network Association. I'll talk about that shortly, but the main point here is that this neural network now takes us from unsupervised to supervised classification. It takes us from working with a single data type to multiple data types. It takes us from elastic property prediction, like we would get from a deterministic inversion, to actual facies themselves. So we're jumping from seismic data and well log data all the way to rock type classification, more importantly, with probabilities. So they carry an uncertainty with that data. So that becomes extremely important. And just like I said with the first arrival picking, what is equally important to the style of the neural network is the inputs that you put into it. So we thought a lot about this and what we allow users to do here to generate those probabilistic facies models is start with the full dimensionality of seismic data. So when we're training our neural networks, and I'm going to use the word plural, neural networks, when we train them, we use pre-stack data, post-stack data, angle stacks, whatever you want. We spend a lot of time on estimating the rock type model at the wellbore. Here we're using our geolog electro-facies classification. That uses a multi-resolution graphic clustering neural network. The value of that is we're able to work and cluster multiple resolutions. That's something you would expect in more challenging depositional environments where you have to differentiate a sand from a laminated sand. That's why that becomes important. So the main point here is before we ever get to the training phase, we put a lot of thought into what our seismic data is. Does it respond? Does it correlate to the wireline data? Does the wireline data correlate to the core data? And when we see that correlation, then we move it to the training and the propagation phase. And I want to talk a little bit about that training phase first, because that training phase and the propagation phase is going to allow us to generate probabilistic facies models. For every facies that goes in, we could generate a probability volume, or we could generate a global probabilistic facies model for the entire data set. The key to this technology, as I said, is to use an ensemble of neural networks, an ensemble of neural networks that are not biased by any classification scheme. So when we train the data initially, we're training it with the multi-dimensional seismic data and our rock type model that we generated with electrofacies classification. And we run that through multiple neural networks that learn something different about that data. Now, what we've also learned with this procedure as well is if we want to introduce softer constraints in the data, we can retrain that. So we can introduce seismic data away from the wellbore, and where it gets this name of DNNA, Democratic Neural Network Association, is we vote, the neural networks vote on whether to let some of that soft data, the seismic data, into the training set. And if it passes, it's allowed in, and eventually we run that neural network again. So that's what gives us our ability to avoid overlearning, and it gives us the ability to avoid biasing in the data. It moves us from a static model to a probabilistic model where we can analyze uncertainties of all different styles of the facies. And this is a very useful output, and it's consistent with the theme that Zvia is going to talk about of moving from exploration to development with this type of data. Now I want to talk a little bit about where we see this going in the future, because everything I talked about up to this point is delivered today in our software technology. I say that current machine learning technologies provide an opportunity to unify a lot of the methodologies that you just saw and also extend their predictive capacity. We started work some time ago on developing convolutional operators or convolutional-like operators with the neural network to solve a broad range of processing problems. And the idea here is to use, again, a backpropagation neural network with one hidden layer that will basically define a convolutional mapping or transformation of input data to desired output using pairs of inputs and desired output. Notice I say pairs of inputs, because that could be multiple attribute volumes. But the idea here is that we have a vector of data, but a single desired output. So clearly we're going to have to move along the seismic temporal or depth direction to generate the desired output. And just to give you some ideas of what this might bring to you, I start with an example at the top of spectral broadening, where you can see the input, the desired output, and the results of that convolutional-like operator to generate the real output. There's an example that we can apply, you see applied to real data. Now, how do you specify that desired output? That could be a shaping of the wavelet, or we can generate a synthetic. We can also use that same type of convolutional operator to cross-equalize data. So if I'm interested in cross-equalizing near, mids, and far angles, again, in this case, we're looking at a near-angle stack, the desired output or being the far-angle stack, and I can equalize those data sets using a convolutional-like operator. That is very applicable to time-lapse or 4D data, and generating a global operator that I can use in that fashion. We can also use the convolutional neural network to derive or predict logs away from wells. So for every seismic trace attributes I have, I can use it to predict logs. That can be very useful for generating a low frequency background model for seismic inversion. And we can also use it for other types or styles of neural network operators. Last topic I want to make with regard to this is the application of deep learning. And for those of you that are involved in neural network technology, deep learning generally uses multiple hidden layers of a neural network to predict. And each of those layers actually contributes different information to the data. So we may start out with a simple convolutional-like filter that I described earlier to start to find certain patterns in that data, and then move that into the deeper part of the neural network to really discriminate with a lot of fidelity different wave types and seismic data. So the example here that I'm going to present is an interesting example, because as always, when Paradigm thinks of neural networks, we not only think of the right topology, but we think of the right input data to go in here. So what I'm demonstrating here is something called a full azimuth directivity gather that we generate with our Earth Study 360 technology. And that full azimuth directivity gather is defined by, in the local angle domain, with a table of opening angles and opening azimuths. In other words, when we generate pre-stacked data that we're going to feed into this deep learning technology, it's going to include five dimensions: the opening angle and azimuth, and then the dip in the azimuth of the local reflecting surfaces. And that's captured in this full azimuth gather. It's a five-dimensional angle gather. That five-dimensional angle gather, if you integrate in two directions, can result in full azimuth directivity and full azimuth reflectivity. The full azimuth directivity gather captures all the different wave types that we can think of. So it captures specular energy, diffraction energy, acquisition noise, anything else. And that allows us then to train that neural network to identify specific data types in that. So the Earth Study 360 technology is technology that we've been maturing for 10 years now. And this is now the first application of deep learning that we're applying to this to better isolate the different energy types that exist in here. So that's some of the things that we're doing with machine learning. What I'd like to do right now is pass this off to Svi Koren, and he's going to talk about a very interesting topic in unifying data and models.
Okay, thank you, Duane. There are so many topics to cover, but what I would like to do in this short session is to start with the position or with the case where assume that a model is there. We're already in production, and there are a few levels there. And of course, building this model we account for a lot of different disciplines and a lot of different types of data. And the idea here is what is needed and what is the technology that is available, and especially, of course, where we believe in paradigm, what are the main components that we have to have a kind of an environment that let us to go from, I call it from the geophysical model, which is more normally more smooth and has some uncertainties, into a more geologically and more with additional informations. So I'll start, of course, with the geo-modeling part. And this is the first thing that we, in Paradigm, we made a huge investment in the last, let's say, 30 years. And it's still, of course, a very active domain. So first of all, the ability to build complex models, it's always a challenge. And having more and more, let's say, faulted blocks and all kind of the different discontinuities with the regional model, this by itself is a very difficult part. But the idea is, and you will see it with the three topics that I want to mention here, that what I want to say, what I want to talk or emphasize is that to split it into two stages. One thing is having the model and having the data and having the method is what is needed, or what can we do, what can we do using the current information that we have. So you can look at it as computing coefficients or computing some information, that this is normally the heavy part of the computation. And then when we want to go into the next stage, we want to generate a lot of scenarios, and we want to explore the all the different, let's say, solutions that we have in all this non-unique problem that we are dealing with. So the second part, this is something that is extremely, extremely important, is when you generate the multi-scenarios, how to apply them on the reference model in order to be able to generate a lot of scenarios. And as you will see, that all of them what we call legal scenarios. And what do we mean by legal scenarios is that they still, you know, honor the invariants of the model, the data. And the data can be the seismic, the data can be the wealth, the data can be the all the geological knowledge and a lot of the other things. So with that, when I say uncertainty analysis, it can go to many, many different things. So I'll show different ways of how do we view the uncertainty in the case where a kind of a background model is already there. And then in order to generate all these legal scenarios, we're going to use here the what we call the tomography engine. And this is a kind of, you know, a solution where we have joint inversion for and introducing all the different types of information in a constrained manner. Finally, at the end, I'll continue with the local angle domain imaging. And what you saw from Duane, for example, is that having a background model, the first thing that we do, we take all the recorded data, the terabytes of data, and try to simulate a kind of, let's say, experiment or seismic data, where all the data is already in situ in the local angle domain. So think about it like you have a kind of a local seismic experiment where you radiate plane waves from all directions and get the scattered energy in situ in depth. Of course, having a kind of a background model in the that is used for that, but now all the data that we have is fully localized in a much smaller area. And then, of course, now when we generate all the data, so you saw, for example, from Duane, an idea of one of the ideas of how to analyze it. We're going to generate a lot of data, and then we need to qualify and quantify and visualize and then analyze. And this, of course, cannot be done anymore by the human being. It can be done maybe in some locations, but we want now the machine to do the work for us. Okay. So the general workflow is, of course, we have the data that is available for us, either seismic data, VSP, potential fields that can be introduced there. Of course, all the different characteristics that we have in the data, the reflections, the refractions, the diffractions, and the other characteristics. All the analysis that we do along the well, and then all this should be constrained. And the idea all the time is that you have to go all the time together with the geological constraint and what the potential of what can be extracted and given by the geophysics. And in terms of, you know, the multi-scenarios and that we have, the uncertainty, it's always what kind of parametrization we use, what are the realizations, what level of anisotropy we are dealing and using, and of course all the internal stratigraphic behavior that we have internally within each formation and so on. And then we build, out of that, we build a reference model that should fit the data and should honor the constraints or the priors or everything that we have there. And this normally, I mean, this can take, I mean, normally a year, 2 years, or 3 years, you know, just to build a full prospect. And during the development and the production, things are changed, and the idea is that we need now more information in order to enhance the oil recovery or to enhance the production. So we want to be in a position that using all the information that we have already had and worked on to generate multi-scenarios, a lot of scenarios, and then to use them in order to get into the next level of accuracy. So running the multiple So any perturbation that we do should finally, I mean, should honor the imaging conditions, either in the reflections or in the directional, or we still need to fit the refraction data to keep the complexity of the shallow model and so on. And finally, at the end, of course, to analyze and to quantify. So let's start with the geomodeling. This is a main core. So I would say the following. I mean, we have, I mean, this is something that, you know, this technology in level like that or like that, we have everywhere. The idea is, first of all, of course, the level of, the high level of science and whatever we have there, but I would say more than that is how to integrate the geological model, these complexities with the other domains that with the seismic and with the wells and with the workflow that we would like to follow. So this is the geomodeling that we have. I won't go too much with that. We can continue. And then this is one example of how to automatically apply the and I'll go more and more about that, because what we generate, for example, from the multi-scenarios, we generate the different perturbations, either in the velocity or anisotropy parameters that we have, and also more difficult are the displacement that we should apply on the reference, the background model, and how to do it in a consistent manner, not to violate, for example, the topology of the model. This is a very challenging task. So the idea is that we have a lot of, I mean, all the available data that we have, either seismic, even with the rich azimuth that we have, with the different wells that we have there, with all the knowledge that we have, still the model, the solution is not unique. The complexity of the subsurface is so high that we can always generate different models that somehow will fit and we'll honor the data that we have. So you can see a simple example where we have two different models, and all of them flood gutters. So flooding gutters, it's one criterion, it's important, but definitely is not enough. And then we can generate. So I won't get, of course, into how we do it, but the whole idea is that we have a lot of combinations, many linear combinations of the velocity models that we have, velocity model parameters, and the structural horizons and depths that we have, and they have a kind of linear relations that all of them should be preserved. And we call that the whole project time-preserving tomography, so it's more, and it is used in many, many different ways. One of the most attractive things is that you have a model and you want to say you have a lot of queries. What if? What if I was wrong here and there is, 5% anisotropy? How is all my model going to change but still honor the data? What if I have some faults here? What if? And things like that. So there is a list of a lot of queries that can be asked, and this machinery can give the solution without rebuilding the model again, applying on the reference model. And this is true for the velocity, for the structure, and so on. Let's move on. So you can see, for example, here, this is what I call a geophysical model, okay? It's not simple. We have some faults, fault blocks. We have some areas, but when we start in a conventional manner in the first stage, we have our grid and it has, the initial structure there. It's not fully sharp, but it's there. Then in a certain stage, we go and we are able to do the interpretation in depth. And we can bring and set all the different areas. And then we want to move into the geological model. So, of course, we have first to simulate or to build a model, and then we get all the velocity and the structural perturbations in a controlled manner that we can control them, and then we can apply them directly on the model. So this is really presenting what I mentioned before, the tomographic engine applied using the SCUA model, and you get all the moving from the geological into the from the geophysical into the geological model, more constrained. And then you see here, so that this is the model, and I took only small part of it, that we have two different models. I cannot say that this is maybe more true than this one, but this is at least, follows the geological decision made by the, by the geologist or the, and in both cases, you see that the image gutters are fully flat. So this is another example of how really to use this machinery. And now we are working on a kind of a system where we have, of course, all the user interface of how to parameterize all these different requirements and how to move them in a kind of a smooth workflow. From the initial reference model, structural model, what happens if the fault is going to change? What is the sensitivity here? And what is the effect on the image and on the priors that we have? So finally, I'll go into the local angle domain system. So what you see here, you see the whole data that we have, all the aperture. It's actually, it can be a few terabytes of data that each, all of them, all of this data, this is all the data that we have that contribute into a single trace image. And it has multidimensionality, the directivity, the opening angles, and so on. But now it's all fully localized in a very specific location. And we can do now, we call it actually, we can do time processing in depth. And that's the main idea. So all the processing system that we have developed for the last, let's say, 50 years, with all the knowledge, we can now do locally with much better, with less approximations and much better decisions. Can we go? So these are a few items that we see, the rich information to reduce the velocity model uncertainty, the localization, the access into the different characteristics, as we showed before, the ability to independently enhance and isolate different characteristics, the specular, the non-specular, what we call diffractions, multiples. We show in many cases that we can even get into, have access into interbed multiples and remove them, or by looking at them at this domain. There are many other issues here, inward and outward. I won't get into that. And of course, one of the let's say one of the project that we are involved now is in re-depthing or re-imaging on the fly while drilling, because the first thing what you do, you bring all the data there. Now the re-migration becomes almost on the fly. So again, even in the imaging part, I want to split it into the, this is the heavy part, which requires the high performance computing. And this is the one that can be accessed into actually any interpreter. And you can work even with workstations, but having the data localized, rich data localized, and do all the type of analysis. So a few examples of the conventional and the local angle domain where you impose the constraints. And this is a very nice example where it's a hidden area here, but again, by enriching from all the different directions, we can see much more. This is another example in the Gulf of Mexico, where the imaging condition that we have in the local angle domain gives us the ability to have much more information in the deeper part, which was not available even when using the, let's say, reverse time migration. This is another case of where you see different conventional tomography and imaging. And can you flip and you see it's a different, the same area, you see different interpretation, and in both cases, when you look at the gathers, they are fully flat. But you can see, I mean, this is something that was driven by the geologists to impose a solution that they believe that is more plausible for that model. So this is the full azimuth information, the rich information that we have there. And before finishing, this is the, I want to show the importance of the full azimuth. And I like this slide very much, this experience. It's a very simple one, shallow model with some low and high local anomalies, where we run the same tomography, but if you run it with single azimuth or no azimuthal dependency, you're totally blind and you don't see anything, and this is what you get. But if you, when we decompose the information into the azimuth domain, then we got actually in the first iteration almost the full solution. So I'll end up with the same example as Duane mentioned. And I say in terms of the, I want to add a little bit to what Duane said in terms of the way we view one aspect of the way we view the machine learning, artificial intelligence, and so on. And this is with respect to a lot of the work that we do now with attributes. We have multi-attributes, each attribute look at the actually at the same subsurface, but with different aspects. We have the geometrical attributes, deep azimuth curvatures, and so on. We have the complex trace, and we have, of course, the spectral decomposition and things like that. And then we want to, at every place, every local place, each of them is more dominant than the others. This can be viewed more or less the same, but we claim that this is one of really the best attribute you can think of. This here you have access into the different contribution to the image coming from a rich information of the directivities. But at every point, only few directions are really contributing into the image. And this is where we do the principal component analysis. We have, this is the best domain to train the data and then to apply it in a deep learning procedure. So, Duane.
Thank you, Zvi. I'll finish with just one comment about how we deliver all this. A lot of the technology that you saw, a lot of you are practitioners. You can do the work yourself. A lot of you may need assistance in doing that work. So getting back to my initial message that software is driving software changes. So we have to think about different ways of delivering technology. And clearly, with the Internet of Things and our ability to connect disparate data, bring in sensor data and so forth, it creates a lot of opportunities for us. And those opportunities allow us to think of different ways to deliver our software to our customers. So this year, we've announced our availability of our applications as they exist today on the cloud in a number of different models. In the first model, we simply do what they call the lift and shift. We take our applications and we basically rehost them on AWS or Azure as they exist today. It gives us some flexibility as to whether the customer would like to do that hosting or we can do that hosting itself. On the full side of things, you have something where we write applications entirely for the cloud with web native applications. And this is something that we are going to be announcing at the SPE in a couple of weeks. And that pure cloud native mode gives us a lot of different advantages in terms of how our customers can interact with our technology, how they can collaborate in different ways as well. And in the high performance computing world, things probably fall in that middle area in the hybrid space where we can write applications, for example, job building applications for seismic processing and imaging, or cluster monitoring applications for processing and imaging, or managing all the jobs that we're running and accumulating statistics. It lends itself very nicely to that hybrid web application model. So that's just some of the ways that we're delivering this new software to our customers to encourage them to work in different styles. And whether it's software licensing or you want to do a geoscience service project with us, it becomes viable.